Are you the type of person that looks at a Mercedes-Benz C-Class and thinks, I wish that was a bit taller, heavier, and more off-roady? Yeah? Sound familiar? Well, this Mercedes-Benz GLC might just be for you.
Using the same platform as the C-Class saloon and estate, the GLC rivals other premium SUVs, including the Alfa Romeo Stelvio, BMW X3, and Audi Q5. 2019 saw the GLC receive a midlife facelift that meant tweaked exterior styling, new engines, and the updated MBUX infotainment system.
Thing is, the C-Class is feeling a bit dated now. So, does this GLC suffer from the same problem, or is it actually a wise way to spend your cash?
The GLC is available with three petrol engines and two diesels, including a bombastic AMG GLC 63S producing 510 horsepower, as well as a frugal 220D 2-litre diesel. All versions are fitted with 4MATIC all-wheel drive and an automatic gearbox.
As you'd expect, the cabin of the GLC is very similar to the C-Class on which it's based. So you've got a kind of more classical design in here. There's lots of swooping lines throughout the dashboard, and on higher spec models at least, there's a bit of wood thrown in for good measure too. That's not to say though that the technology in here isn't cutting edge, because unlike the Mercedes C-Class saloon and estate, the GLC has got the newer MBUX infotainment system, which we've also seen on the A-Class, the B-Class, the GLB, cars like that. And I've got to say, it's a big improvement over the older command system, which is really starting to feel properly long in the tooth now. MBUX, though, has just got so much more functionality. It's easier to use. The graphics are much crisper. It's on this nice 10.25-inch touchscreen, but you can also use it with a touchpad down here, so you've got two different ways to control it. And you can also actually, saying that, you can also control it by voice recognition. And if I say what that voice recognition is called, it'll activate. So just bear with me here. It's called, "Hey Mercedes.
How may I help you?"
See, so she now asks what she can do to help, and you can do lots of things such as adjust the ambient lighting, you can change the temperature, you can change the music, and do pretty much everything. So to give you an example, turn the driver's side heated seat on.
Okay, I'm switching on the seat heating on the driver's seat.
And there you go, my heated seat has now come on, as you can maybe just about see there, and I've got a lovely toasty bottom. Now, voice recognition systems can be a bit hit and miss, but I've got to say, the MBUX system, it has improved throughout its short lifespan so far, and it genuinely has got a lot better, and it is one of the more accurate systems out there. My only issue with this infotainment system is that you can't get Apple CarPlay or Android Auto on sport spec, which is this one, or AMG line. You've got to go AMG line premium or above. It's not even available as an option on those two base trims. You really do need to pay for the more expensive trim, and there the Apple CarPlay and the Android Auto is fitted as standard. And I don't want to sound like a moaning millennial, but it's such a good piece of software, and many, many other rivals offer it as standard on much lower trim levels and on cars that don't cost £40,000. So it's just a shame that Mercedes hasn't been able to fit it as standard.
Upgrade to the AMG line premium trim level, and MBUX also comes with augmented reality navigation, where virtual arrows and indicators are overlaid on top of a real-time view of the road ahead.
As I said, this is a base spec sport model GLC, so we've got the standard analog dials with a digital screen in the middle. You can get an optional digital dashboard display, which's got a 12.3-inch widescreen setup, which has got everything digital and can be customized accordingly. But this setup here with the analog dials and the screen in the middle isn't actually a bad compromise, because the dials themselves are very clear, They do the job nicely. And the screen in the middle, it's still color, it's still crisp and sharp, and you can go through driver assistance, the trip computer, navigation, radio, media, all the important settings using the touchpad buttons on either side of the wheel here. Finally, the driving position. This is obviously an SUV, so I am quite high up, but you do get, as standard, electric backrest adjustment and base adjustment too, so I can move myself up and down. And honestly, for an SUV, it's got, if you choose, a fairly low down driving position compared to what other models offer you. You don't have to be right up there, but if you choose to do that, then you can get a really good commanding view out. There's also plenty of adjustment in the wheel too, so you should be able to get comfortable no matter how tall or short you are.
The GLC has a high starting price, but that does mean standard equipment is generous, with all models featuring automatic parking, an electronic tailgate, privacy glass, and the MBUX infotainment system.
Space in the back of the GLC is really very good indeed. I particularly like how much foot room I've got, so I've got lots of space to wiggle my toes around underneath the driver's seat, and I've also got lots of headroom and knee room as well. Although just bear in mind that if you go for the optional panoramic sunroof, it will take away precious inches from the space between your head and the roof. If you're going to put someone in the middle here, then also look at the size of the central tunnel, because although that's pretty normal for this type of car, it does mean that the middle seat passenger will have to thread their legs down either side of the central tunnel and impinge on the legroom for the people in the outer rear seats. If we look just in front of that, we can see two USB-C charging points. There's also a 12-volt socket there as well. And you've got these pockets behind the passenger and the driver's seat. You've got a decent size of door pockets there as well. And central armrest, pretty normal. Little storage space as well. And then the outer seat ISOFIX points, which are clearly marked too.
The GLC delivers 550 litres of boot space with all five seats in place and 1,600 litres with them folded down. A useful amount that is competitive with both the BMW X3 and Audi Q5 for outright luggage capacity. Before we continue to the driving section, here are four things you need to know before buying a Mercedes-Benz GLC. The GLC has had three safety recalls in its lifetime. This isn't unusual, but do make sure that all issues have been fixed by the manufacturer if buying second-hand. When tested in 2015, the Mercedes-Benz GLC was awarded a 5-star Euro NCAP safety rating. The GLC was updated in 2019 with tweaked styling, new powertrains, and the upgraded MBUX infotainment system. Mercedes-Benz offers a choice of 9 exterior paint colours on the GLC, such as Brilliant Blue Metallic, Designo Hyacinth Red, and Obsidian Black Metallic.
Now, the big difference between the GLC and the C-Class is that on the GLC, you can get regular models with adaptive air suspension. However, that's only on the AMG line Ultimate versions, which is actually a bit of a shame because those have also got the larger alloy wheels. However, with this base sport spec car and its 18-inch alloy wheels and its fixed comfort suspension, you've got a pretty good compromise on the ride quality. Okay, it's not perfect. It does struggle with some sharper bumps and you can feel expansion joints if you hit them at a bit of an angle. But aside from that, I haven't really got any major complaints to speak of. There's a fair amount of rubber between the wheel and the road, so it feels cushioned over most surfaces, and at high speeds especially, it's actually a pretty relaxed cruiser. What's more, the whole car feels like it's been sympathetically set up to the whole luxurious SUV thing, because a lot of cars like this will try and be sporty when they haven't really got the technology, say the adaptive suspension, to match. But this, it doesn't feel like it's trying to be sporty, and as a result, it's got quite a nice, relaxed, lolloping gait, which makes a change. If you do happen across some Benz in your GLC, then you'll notice that body roll is actually kept surprisingly well in check, despite that soft suspension. You've also got a lot of grip too, and an electronic stability control system that will step in very, very keenly if you overstep the margins. One real complaint though with the handling, and it's to do with this speed sensitive steering, which is standard on all GLCs, or at least all regular GLCs, because when you'll go through a corner, it'll change how quick the steering is depending on how much lock you've got on. So the ratio changes, or it can change midway through a corner. Now, when you're going at low speeds in town, it's actually quite handy because it can make the GLC feel quite agile. But at higher speeds, when you're trying to judge a corner and how much steering input you need, it's not as good, and it can leave you sort of second guessing exactly what's going on.
The post-facelift GLC 220D uses a new 2-litre four-cylinder diesel to send power to all four wheels using a 9-speed automatic gearbox. Producing 194 horsepower and 400 newton-metres of torque, it's good for 0 to 62 miles an hour in a respectable 7.9 seconds and a top speed of 134 miles an hour.
Now, one of the main complaints about the 2.1 litre turbocharged diesel in the pre-facelift GLC was that it was very, very noisy. The good news is it's been replaced by this 2-litre diesel in the post-facelift model, and, well, it's a lot quieter. It's far less gruff at low revs, and it's just smoother right the way through the rev range and as you accelerate up to a red line of about 5,500 RPM. I've got to say though, it's still not quite as quiet as an Audi Q5's 2-litre diesel or a BMW X3's 2-litre diesel. So, you know, maybe a bit of a disappointment, but you know, those are very good as diesels go for keeping the noise levels down, and this just doesn't quite match up to it. But then at a cruise, you really can't hear it at all. It's very well hushed, as is the rest of the car, actually. It's just at lower speeds where it slightly falls behind. But then again, if you're used to the older diesel in the GLC, then this, as I said, is a big improvement. On the flip side, this engine may make a lot of noise, but it's got a lot of punch to go with it, because it's got 400 newton meters of torque, and it feels every ounce of that, because you put your foot down any speed, any gear, and it really picks up the speed really, really well. It's got excellent acceleration. I've got to say, it feels quicker than the 2-litre diesel 190 horsepower Audi Q5 that I ran a couple of years ago. And I reckon it's also got the measure of an equivalent BMW X3 as well. It's really impressive. And the gearbox is smooth, it's slick. It's got 9 ratios, but it chooses when to deploy each one wisely. And also, if you need that burst of speed, it changes down quickly as well. If you're looking to buy a Mercedes-Benz GLC, but you don't know which one to go for, then here are our top 3 choices. For the cheapest one available, it's this, the GLC 220D Sport. And it's the same if you're a company car driver too, thanks to its 32% BIK tax rating. Finally, if you're a performance fan, you want the Mercedes AMG GLC 63S.
It may not be getting any younger, but the Mercedes-Benz GLC has benefited hugely from its 2019 facelift. New tech, engines, and updated styling means it's still comparable to fresher rivals, while madcap AMG versions still lend this Mercedes SUV a welcome sense of humour. Slightly noisier diesel engines and the feeling that the BMW X3 and Audi Q5 are newer and more polished may count against the GLC, but rest assured that this Mercedes-Benz is still a serious alternative to its fresher rivals.